Major funding for war and peace in the nuclear age was provided by the Annenberg CPB Project. Additional funding was provided by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies for over 100 years, providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. And by the W. Walton Jones Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, public television stations, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
We are dealing with mad dogs who have no regard for morals, human life, or decency. We must treat them accordingly. I urge that the atomic bomb be used if it can be used efficiently. These dirty communists should be shown how tough war can be. In my books, one American boy is worth more than all of Asia.
The fear and suspicion of the Cold War, passions that would shape the politics of the nuclear age. American troops hit the beaches, practicing for battle on the fringe of Asia. They're here for reasons that go back to 1950, when the Cold War suddenly turned hot in Korea. For more than a generation, they've been locked in a dangerous standoff, and more than once, it has threatened to slide into awesome destruction. The U.S. Army's Buffalo base is just 15 yards from the demilitarized zone between North and South Korea. These soldiers are part of the 40,000 U.S. troops stationed here, most of them born long after the Korean War.
I didn't know what I was getting into at all. I didn't know anything about Korea before I came. You see MASH on TV, that's what you think of Korea. When I came here, I was really surprised.
Our mission is, we're trained to, recover people that wander into minefields. We're trained to go out and resupply people. And we're also trained to, if we ever have to, come in close combat with the North Koreans.
The Americans patrol here, along the tense east-west divide, 5,000 miles from America's borders. Like all U.S. troops, they're backed by the most powerful weapons on Earth. These nuclear-capable F-16s fly out of Kunsan Air Force Base, widely believed to be the only U.S. forward base in Asia where nuclear weapons are permanently stored. America's presence in Korea is a legacy of a dangerous chapter in the nuclear age, a time when former allies became adversaries and nuclear weapons became the weapons of choice. August 1945, the end of World War II. In the Soviet Union, Britain, and America, the celebration went on for days. An outpouring of relief and joy. But it was the Americans who had the most to cheer about. Their awesome new weapon, the atom bomb, had helped end the war and bring the boys back home. Leading America into the nuclear age was President Harry Truman. Only in office a few months, Truman was entering uncharted waters. How would the first and only nuclear-armed nation define its responsibilities and exercise its power?
Arriving for the Navy Day address, which has been heralded as a major declaration of American foreign policy, a million people are gathered to hear President Truman.
We must find the answer to the problems created by the release of atomic energy. the possession in our hands of this new power of destruction, we regard as a sacred trust.
Truman, the guardian of the atomic secret, then sent a warning to those who might challenge American interests.
We shall refuse to recognize any government imposed upon any nation by the force of any foreign power.
Truman was most concerned about devastated Europe and the actions there of his wartime ally, the Soviet Union. Amid these ruins, the competition that would define the nuclear age took shape. With millions of refugees and little food, Europe was a wasteland, a breeding ground of disease and despair. It had to be rebuilt, but under whose political banner? Both sides, the Soviets and Americans, were convinced the other was gaining an advantage here. Both sides were full of mistrust. The Soviets had planted their flag firmly over half the continent. After defeating Hitler's armies in Eastern Europe, they had stayed on to support local communist regimes friendly to Moscow. The result was a protective ring of subservient countries.
The Soviet Union wanted to have a consolidated security. I mean, the Soviet Union had a lawful national interest. Soviet Union, Soviet people spilled a lot of blood in defeating fascism. And they didn't want to return to the situation when the Soviet Union would be surrounded with a ring of hostile states.
Determined to protect their gains, the Soviets maintained a large and powerful army. Its massive size would be used to justify America's nuclear readiness. For his part, the Soviet leader, Joseph Stalin, pretended to be unimpressed by the Americans' new atomic might as he continued to build the Red Army. Soviet citizens were constantly reminded that defense of the homeland was a patriotic duty. Even these tiny cadets, whose fathers had been killed in the war, were taught the art of fighting. Their country had suffered 20 million casualties. It would not be caught off guard again. The Soviets had 175 divisions under arms, but that didn't change one vital fact. The Americans had the bomb, and the Russians didn't.
No matter how many divisions the Soviet Union had at that time, no matter how many people in the army at that time was, the nuclear weapon, that the decisive power that the United States had at that time.
In an all-out effort to catch up, the Soviets had launched a secret campaign to develop their own atomic bomb, bringing together the country's leading scientists and engineers.
The Soviet scientists, headed by Khrushchev, advanced step by step along this untrodden path. To start the attack on the atom, it was necessary to link up fundamental research, technical work, engineering thought, and the practical organization of the whole vast undertaking. But the overriding concern of one and all, from scientist down to worker, was to assure the security of the country by making the atomic bomb.
We were faced by the imbalance in nuclear power that existed between our countries in this moment. And as it was obvious that things were the alliance that so happily existed during the war against Hitler had collapsed. And we entered a new phase of this Cold War, whatever you call this period, where the nuclear weapons became a decisive element in the balance of power.
But unknown to the Soviets, their vision of an all-powerful American atomic arsenal was, in fact, a mirage. The production of bombs at the National Laboratory at Los Alamos had been drastically scaled down after the war. The atomic cupboard was practically bare.
I remember when the Atomic Energy Commission took over and Bob Bakker went out. He was a scientific member of the commission. Went out to Los Alamos, he was dismayed and flabbergasted to find there was not a single weapon ready to be used. It was in 46. And we didn't have very many for the next couple of years. So we were shadow boxing in a way. The world thought we probably had dozens and dozens of them, and we didn't.
But for many of the scientists who had helped to create the bomb, its very existence was enough to trouble them.
We were worried that the public doesn't know enough how terrible this weapon is and how different this weapon is from the conventional weapons. We also felt that many people, including leading politicians, thought that America will have that secret forever and that other nations will never be able to construct a nuclear bomb. And it was quite clear to us, and especially to those people like myself who've been in Soviet Russia and knew the kind of physics they know and do, that this is sort of ridiculous, that the one big secret is that it is possible.
The most eloquent spokesman for the troubled scientists was Robert Oppenheimer, who had led the Los Alamos bomb project during the war.
I have been asked whether, in the years to come, it will be possible to kill 40 million American people in the 20 largest American towns by the use of atomic bombs in a single night. I am afraid that the answer to that question is yes. I have been asked whether there are specific countermeasures against the atomic bomb. I do not think there is any foundation for the hope that such countermeasures will be found. I have been asked whether there is hope for the nation's security in keeping secret some of the knowledge which has gone into the making of the bombs. I am afraid there is no such hope. I think the only hope for our future safety must lie in a collaboration based on confidence and good faith with the other peoples of the world.
In this spirit, a bold proposal, drafted initially by Oppenheimer, for the international control of atomic energy was taken up by the Truman administration.
One of the most amazing documents ever written in modern history, we were offering to give up a valuable weapon for strict, enforceable international control. I remember stories about congressmen sitting up half the night reading it with great excitement. I did so myself.
America's advisor to President Bernard Baruch arrives for the first session of the United Nations Atomic Energy Commission. After months of study, he brings a momentous report, a program to outlaw atomic war.
We are here to make a choice between the quick and the dead. That is our business. Behind the black portent of the new atomic age lies a hope which, seized upon with faith, can work our salvation.
The United States proposed that an international agency be established to control the use of fissionable materials by the nations of the world. If this were done successfully, America would then surrender or destroy its own atomic bombs. But there were problems with the plan. Baruch insisted on granting the agency the power to inspect all nations and punish offenders, based on a majority vote of the Security Council, which was heavily pro-American and anti-Soviet.
The Baruch plan was based on the supposition that the only country and the monopoly is of the United States. So everything that is going to be developed or was going to be developed at that time should be under the control of the United States. They have to be a world inspector, and all countries must confide in them.
Our lengthy meetings with Baruch and other American representatives, where we tried to call their attention to the absurdity of the American stance on this matter, didn't give any positive results, unfortunately.
The Soviets feared the plan would freeze them in a permanent state of nuclear inferiority. Secretly, they were determined to build their own bomb. As the debate dragged on, the U.S. military pursued its mission, a recurring theme in the nuclear age. Anxious to test new weapons and build up its atomic arsenal, the military set off the first post-war explosion at Bikini Atoll in the Pacific.
The bombardier's supreme test is at hand as the bomb bay doors open. To protect their eyes against the flash which blotted out the morning sun, men are adequately prepared as HR approaches. Even with these goggles, they saw a stab of light as brilliant as lightning. The bomb is away!
The timing of the test during the UN debate was mostly coincidental. Still, it was the first example of what would become a constant tension between military needs and arms control. The Soviets, meanwhile, complained that the test was an unnecessary show of force as they moved ahead with their own secret atomic research. On December 5, 1946, the first Soviet reactor achieved a chain reaction, a major step on the road to a viable nuclear weapon. A few days later, Baruch addressed the UN.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the report of this commission be submitted to the Security Council on December the 31st, 1946.
On the last day of 1946, Baruch called for a vote. Anything less than unanimous acceptance would doom the U.S. arms control plan.
Brazil?
Yes.
Canada?
Yes.
China?
Yes.
Egypt?
Yes.
France?
Oui.
Mexico?
Yes.
The Netherlands?
Yes.
Poland?
Abstain.
The USSR?
The Soviet Union and her satellite Poland abstained. The Baruch plan was dead. The world would never again come so close to the possibility of total disarmament.
It was too much to expect that shortly after the end of the war, we could really get to an international agreement, so to speak, to an abolishment of war. It was just not time enough for the world to get accustomed to this new idea. Nobody knew about the nuclear bomb except a few of us. And here, August 6, 1945, the world changed. The whole idea of warfare changed. And it takes more than a few years for the world to understand it. As Einstein said, the whole world was changed by the nuclear bomb except our way of thinking.
The year 1947 rang in cold and bleak. The exultation at the end of World War II seemed like ancient history. The United Nations had failed in its first test to resolve the most important issue of the times. The Cold War between the U.S. and Soviet Union had begun in earnest. But the hot wars would be fought by proxies. In Greece, local communist guerrillas threatened to overthrow the U.S.-backed government. President Truman offered aid.
I believe that it must be the policy of the United States to support free peoples who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures.
Instead of sending troops, the U.S. sent dollars. Truman pledged millions in economic and military aid to Greece and neighboring Turkey. Within months, this aid was extended to become the Marshall Plan, a massive economic package offered to both Eastern and Western Europe.
I do not have to tell you that this foreign economic program of the United States seeks no special advantage and pursues no sinister purpose. It is a program of construction, production, and recovery. It menaces no one.
But the Soviet Union and her communist allies in Europe believed otherwise. For them, Marshall aid was a naked attempt to buy loyalty for the United States and undercut the communists who couldn't possibly compete with American largesse. The more successful the aid program, the harsher their attacks.
These starving people are supposed to be grateful to Mr. Marshall. He has sent them canned horse meat, one can a week per family. It would be nicer if the horse meat weren't rotten.
Czechoslovakia, a nation with a long tradition of liberalism.
Caught in the U.S.-Soviet tug-of-war was Czechoslovakia, which had been friendly to both sides. But when it flirted with an offer of U.S. aid, the Czech government was toppled by communists backed by Moscow.
We had hoped that Czechoslovakia could remain independent. When the coup took place and they moved in, and Czechoslovakia, in effect, fell to Soviet domination, it made the president more conscious of the fact that the one great foreign policy problem of the United States was the Soviet Union.
Truman decided the U.S. had to rebuild its armed forces to match the Soviets. As a first step, military training should be made compulsory for all American men.
This boy is an American who will shortly take his place in the atomic age. He is confident. He has learned his capabilities. He is strong. He has worked and played in fresh air and sunlight. He is morally clean, for nothing his parents gave him has been taken away.
The plan calls for our registration on our 17th birthday. We could begin training.
The program was unpopular in the country. The Congress turned it down. The reason was that the mothers of America didn't want their sons to be involved in any such program. And the political vicissitudes of the plan were too apparent to the members of Congress.
But there was one very attractive alternative to more troops, and that was more atom bombs. They were cheaper than soldiers and more acceptable to Congress. In the spring of 1948, the military launched Operation Sandstone in the Pacific to build up the American stockpile. Until now, each bomb was handcrafted. Operation Sandstone was designed to open the way to the mass production of smaller, more powerful bombs.
We were trying to improve the stockpile, make better weapons, get more bang for a buck, if you will, as a natural process of evolution of the weapons business.
We thought, first of all, we should see to it to make them smaller so that they could be delivered by smaller planes instead of having a bomb which was that big. We would have one which was only this big.
To the scientists, the explosions were a stunning technical success. And to politicians, they were a potent sign of strength. Few worried about their effect on the Cold War. The politics of confrontation had replaced negotiation. In Berlin, a few months later, tensions between the U.S. and Russia flared again. This time over the vital issue of the future of Germany. At the end of the war, defeated Germany had been split into four zones of occupation, one for each of the victorious allies. The former capital, Berlin, was left 100 miles inside the Soviet zone, but under joint command. By 1948, this fragile arrangement was under growing strain. U.S. policymakers wanted a strong, revitalized Germany to help speed Europe's recovery. But for Moscow, the prospect of a powerful new Germany tied to the West brought back their worst fears of a German invasion. In June, the Soviets challenged their former allies. All passenger and freight traffic from the western zones was cut off by a Soviet blockade. 2 million West Berliners were left isolated, without coal or food.
On course, on the glide path, very good. Now, over the end of the runway, azimuth and elevation.
Within 24 hours came the Western response, a massive airlift of food and supplies into the beleaguered city. The only alternative was to use military force, but few in the West were willing to trade soldiers' lives to liberate Germans who had recently been the enemy. But Washington had one other card to play. While its planes delivered food to hostage West Berlin, America's nuclear arsenal became a weapon of diplomacy. In a highly publicized show of strength, American B-29 bombers were flown to bases in England, the same type of plane used to drop atomic bombs on Japan.
Once again to airfields in Lincolnshire, 3 years after the war, come American superfortresses with guns loaded and manned. The great war planes sidle in as if aware of their own significance at this grave time in the diplomacy of the Western Allies.
Когда появились атомные стратегические бомбардировщики.
I knew about the atomic strategic bombers based in England the moment they arrived. It was in 1948, and I was a student at the General Staff Academy. And my thought was already tuned strategically, as we had been taught, and not in terms of tactics. We were evaluating the United States' nuclear potential, and in particular, those 90 atomic bombers with one or two bombs aboard. That meant approximately 200 bombs, which was a real threat, 200 Hiroshimas.
By sending the B-29s to England, we hoped to leave the impression that they were armed with nuclear weapons and we were prepared to use them. The fact of the matter is they were not armed. There were no nuclear components in them. But we hoped the Russians didn't know that, or anybody else, and it was psychological warfare.
But the U.S. nuclear threat in Berlin was balanced by Russia's enormous edge in conventional forces.
Western powers made this, especially the United States, made this trial of strength, but they were not prepared to go to war with the Soviet Union at that time, with Central Europe. It was simply the crazy idea, despite even the atomic bomb, because they knew that if the atomic drums would be dropped on the Soviet Union, the few that the United States had, then the Western Europe would be occupied by the Soviet forces who would be trying, to clear the danger. And then all this whole thing would be counterproductive.
For each position of strength, there was a position of weakness. For each threat, there was a counter-threat. It was the first great stalemate of the nuclear age. And there would be many more to follow.
Is it possible that the Americans will be forced out of Berlin?
We are not going to be forced out of Berlin.
Will you be able to continue the present air supply indefinitely?
We will increase it, and we can continue it indefinitely.
The airlift continued into 1949. And the Soviet Union gradually realized that the West would not abandon its plans for an independent West German state.
When the formation of two German states and so on had become inevitable, then we met you and agreed to end the Berlin blockade. But the price of this was the mutual acceptance of a divided Europe. It's turning into two armed camps as it still exists today.
In May 1949, after 11 months, the Soviet blockade was lifted. West Berlin was free again. But the political map of Europe had been transformed, with Germany divided. All hopes that Europe might return to normal were dashed. The lines were drawn, and it was the United States, with her atomic arsenal, who had become the champion of the Western side. Even before the blockade had ended, Washington made a dramatic pledge to its allies in Europe.
The setting, Washington, D.C. The date, April 4th, 1949. And here, within these walls, one of the great treaties of human history is about to be signed.
NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, linked the U.S., Canada, and 10 West European countries in a political and military alliance. Within 6 years, they would be joined by Greece, Turkey, and West Germany. the NATO treaty promised U.S. military help to Western Europe in the event of a Soviet-backed invasion, though left unsaid, that American promise included nuclear weapons. The bomb had come to Europe.
The major value of NATO, oversimplified, was NATO said to the Soviet Union, attack any one of our allies in Europe, and you have attacked the United States, and you are at war with the United States.
But the Soviets saw it differently.
The main principle of NATO, as it was formed and formulated, was a doctrine designed for the ousting of the Soviet Union. That doctrine meant pushing the Soviet Union back from the positions it reached as a result of the Second World War.
In Western Europe, NATO was warmly welcomed. For many, the American atomic bomb was a blessing.
I must not conceal from you tonight the truth as I see it. It is certain that Europe would have been communized like Czechoslovakia and London under bombardment some time ago, but for the deterrent of the atomic bomb in the hands of the United States.
To meet its NATO commitments to Western Europe, the United States looked to its nuclear bomber force as a cheap yet powerful solution. The new B-36 intercontinental bomber was designed to fit the strategy exactly.
The big bomber had a much greater carrying capacity than any other aircraft so far produced. There was room in the four big bomb bays for 100 500-pound bombs. Or, when tremendously big ones were needed, the cargo could be two bombs, each weighing 21 tons.
With the building of the long-range B-36, the United States could now threaten targets deep inside the Soviet Union from bases on American soil.
We were solving a problem: how do you contain Russia with a given amount of money? And see, we were at the same time in 49, starting NATO. And the question was, how do you defend Europe? And Europeans were only willing to spend so much money. The cheapest way to give a defense at that time was the threat of using atomic weapons.
Again, the Soviets did their best to discredit America's nuclear policy.
American imperialists manufacture atomic bombs. Waving their atomic bomb, they are attempting to frighten mankind in order to achieve world domination and to establish their way of life all over the world, this so-called American way of life.
To counter America's nuclear diplomacy, the Soviet government supported a worldwide peace campaign, condemning atomic weapons. But the Soviets had also been hard at work on a far more effective strategy: getting a bomb of their own. In August 1949, the Soviet Union also made the atomic bomb its weapon of choice.
I felt proud for the Soviet people, for the Soviet working class, for Soviet science, because of the short period in which we managed to acquire such weapons.
The feeling was, we made it, you know. Now we feel ourselves better. We could talk to the Americans on a more equal footing. That was the feeling after it was officially announced.
The first Soviet atomic bomb tests didn't promote a better relationship between the Soviet Union and Western powers. That's obvious. But it would have been much worse if the Soviet Union hadn't had its own nuclear bomb. Above all, the Soviet Union would have been in a worse situation.
In the U.S., confidence in American security was shattered. Most people had believed that Soviet scientists would take many years to catch up, if they ever could.
We were very ignorant of just how good the Russians were. We all like to think they're just a bunch of bearded Bolsheviks throwing conventional bombs around, Molotov cocktails, all thumbs who couldn't do anything of any consequence. And they certainly told us that was not the case.
My reaction to the news of the Soviet bomb was to be aghast at the reaction of Washington, which was that no preparation had been made in state or defense for this ending of the United States monopoly of atomic weapons. There was a vacuum created, and one man saw this and grabbed the opportunity. That was Edward Teller.
Teller had worked at Los Alamos during the war. He had argued constantly for research on a vastly more powerful weapon, the hydrogen bomb. Otherwise, he said, the Soviets will get there first.
Shortly after Hiroshima, Stalin has said, we in Russia will have the atomic bomb, and we will have much more. This I could not forget. I knew, I have known for years, about the possibility of the hydrogen bomb. I could not quite see what we should do next. I was working then temporarily at Los Alamos. And one day, Ernest Lawrence called and asked to see me. He came, listened to how far we have gotten with the hydrogen bomb. He had similar worries as I did. And he said, with the knowledge we already have, there is no question, but we must go ahead.
Unlike the atom bomb, which works through the splitting of heavy atoms, the hydrogen bomb would rely on fusion, or the fusing together of lighter atoms. If it worked, the difference in power in a bomb would be immense. The early atom bombs could lay waste an area covering 1.5 miles from the point of explosion. The devastation from a 50-megaton hydrogen bomb would spread across 40 miles, with radiation effects up to 100 miles away. But the technical problems in creating such a bomb were tremendous.
History again and again shows that we have no monopoly on ideas, but we do better with them than most other countries.
All I am trying to develop...
In 1949, Robert Oppenheimer was appointed to lead a panel of experts to investigate the pros and cons of these so-called thermonuclear weapons. Their top-secret report came down strongly against development. The hydrogen bomb, they said, raised serious practical questions and moral ones as well.
Essentially, the position we took was this idea was a terrible thing, extremely destructive, and in a certain sense, immoral. It was so destructive that it amounted to genocide.
I came to the conclusion that I did not want this development to take place. I was convinced that we were strong enough in fission bombs to wait it out and to be stronger than the Soviets in this area for a long, long time to come.
Oppenheimer and his colleagues argued instead for a larger stockpile of more compact, efficient, and usable atomic weapons made by the old fission method. But the debate over hydrogen weapons became increasingly bitter.
I think Robert hoped that it couldn't be made. It would turn out to be impossible. He was very much frightened of putting in a new weapon of this potential character into the hands of the world. He knew, and quite rightly, that once we succeeded in doing it successfully, that all the rest of the nuclear world would do the same thing.
Their argument was that an atomic bomb is powerful enough, and if we are not going to work on anything more powerful, the Russians won't do so either. Because of Stalin's earlier statement, I could not accept that argument. Here were a number of very excellent scientists arguing that we should not look into a possibility. They argued for continued ignorance, and this I could not accept.
When does killing become immoral? Does it become immoral just because you have a bigger weapon? Now, we've been bombing civilians, which at one point was frowned upon, all through World War II. In other words, we disregarded that moral argument that you don't bomb civilians. Well, if you're going to bomb civilians, you might as well do it efficiently.
President Truman appointed a special committee of three, including the secretaries of state and defense, to advise him on the H-bomb decision.
The president had one question. He said, can the Russians do this? And everybody agreed they could. And Sauer said, we don't have much time, Mr. President. The president said, we'll go ahead.
Truman, the man who had dropped the atom bomb on Japan, but then called for nuclear disarmament, was now initiating a quantum leap forward in the arms race. His ambivalence about nuclear weapons was overcome by his fears of falling behind.
President Truman's momentous decision to make the hydrogen bomb rocks the world. The news is blacked out behind the Iron Curtain, but in the United States, headlines from coast to coast carry the president's announcement.
I want the United States to make the hydrogen bomb so that no country will dare to threaten our peace.
God grant we never use another bomb, but its possession would seem necessary for security.
Truman's decision on the H-bomb came amid new fears of Soviet villainy. Klaus Fuchs, who had worked on the American bomb during the war, had just been arrested as a communist spy. Fuchs confessed that he had passed details of U.S. atomic and H-bomb research to the Russians.
One of the greatest peacetime spy dramas in the nation's history reaches its climax.
Atomic espionage became a constant theme for politicians and the press after the Fuchs case exposed a network of atomic spies. Sensational trials like those of Julius and Ethel Rosenberg fueled hatred of the Soviets and unleashed a firestorm of anti-communism. Preying on American fears of Soviet espionage, Senator Joseph McCarthy began a campaign to expose alleged communists within the government.
Senator, you are, of course, one of the most controversial figures we've had in the Senate in a long time, and you have the distinction of having coined a new word for the dictionary, namely McCarthyism. Now, how do you define McCarthyism, sir?
Apparently, McCarthyism means calling a man a communist who is later proven to be one.
Do you think that you have been guilty of any un-Americanism yourself in your efforts to combat what you define as un-Americanism?
If fighting communists and getting a bit rough with them, Mr. Huey, is un-American, then I must plead guilty to being un-American.
Do you think that you used
McCarthy's anti-communism would become a mania, stirring fears that would eventually engulf many innocent people, including Robert Oppenheimer.
I think most scientists are inclined to be rather liberal and therefore were possible targets of Joe McCarthy. Nearly everybody felt threatened, felt insecure, because almost anybody could be called before McCarthy and undergo a very disagreeable and probably very damaging interview.
Against the background of McCarthy's zealous hunt for communists, the Atomic Energy Commission eventually removed Oppenheimer's security clearance. FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover, who falsely accused Oppenheimer of being a Soviet agent, defined communism this way.
Communism in reality is not a political party. It is a way of life, an evil and malignant way of life. It reveals a condition akin to disease that spreads like an epidemic. And like an epidemic, a quarantine is necessary to keep it from infecting this nation.
But the U.S. could not quarantine the world. By December of 1949, the Red Army of Mao Zedong had defeated America's long-standing ally, Chiang Kai-shek. Half a billion Chinese joined the enemy camp. As the Soviets consolidated their alliance with the Chinese, there was a fundamental reassessment of U.S. thinking on defense. The resulting report on U.S. military options, known as NSC 68, painted a stark picture of the Soviet Union as a deadly opponent. The Soviets, it argued, were now pursuing world domination, and they were armed with nuclear weapons. By 1954, the Soviets could have 200 atomic bombs with the ability to drop half of them on American targets. The report's tone was urgent. The U.S. must immediately build up its forces, both conventional and nuclear. Within weeks, the report's recommendations were given new credibility. In June 1950, communist troops from North Korea invaded the South. Washington believed the surprise attack had Soviet approval, and that Korea was just a prelude to similar actions in Europe, backed by the Soviet Union's new atomic weaponry. Overnight, the hard line set out in NSC 68 seemed confirmed. Objections over defense spending were pushed aside. The U.S. defense budget was tripled. But America was reluctant to use atomic weapons. In the early stages of the war, U.S. troops fighting under the U.N. flag relied on conventional warfare. And after a number of setbacks, the strategy seemed to be working. But then came an unexpected and alarming change in the flow of battle. In November, Chinese communist troops crossed the Yalu River into South Korea. With Moscow's most important ally now joining the conflict, Washington braced itself for another world war.
At the White House in Washington, top defense officials of the nation gathered to discuss the gravest world crisis since Poland and Pearl Harbor. The unexpected entry of 300,000 Red Chinese across the Manchurian border may well precipitate World War III. President Truman voices his accusation of Red imperialism.
If the United Nations yields to the forces of aggression, no nation will be safe or secure. If aggression is successful in Korea, we can expect it to spread throughout Asia and Europe and to this hemisphere.
Later, to reporters, Truman hinted that America might use the atomic bomb in Korea. Despite official denials, the president's remarks did not go unnoticed in China. But the Chinese either didn't believe the American threat or felt that the risk was worth taking. And so the war dragged on. With no end in sight, it became increasingly unpopular with Americans back home. A painful drain of money and lives. The U.S. general in charge of the U.N. forces, Douglas MacArthur, was known to favor using atomic weapons. Following atrocities against captured American troops, MacArthur's tough line attracted growing support.
We are dealing with mad dogs. You have no regard for morals, human life, or decency. We must treat them accordingly. I urge that the atomic bomb be used if it can be used efficiently. These dirty communists should be shown how tough war can be. In my books, one American boy is worth more than all of Asia.
And yet, despite the tough rhetoric at home, the U.S. never crossed the nuclear threshold in Korea. Among the reasons was one that underscored the limitations of America's nuclear option. On a battlefield where both sides were so entwined and the nuclear arsenal so small, atomic warfare made little sense.
There were no suitable targets. And if we used them ineffectively, it would have the psychological effect of reducing our stockpile by 50%, probably. And there's no point in using them if they didn't have proper targets. I don't think there are any moral compunctions.
I always felt General Vandenberg had the soundest argument for not using atomic weapons in Korea. His argument was that we had so few that it would debunk the use, the threat of atomic weapons.
But a new man was about to enter the White House with a new approach to the nuclear option in Korea.
20,000 miles and 16 days later, President-elect Eisenhower returns to New York, brimming with confidence after his tour of the Korean front. Commenting on his trip, made with the top advisors of his forthcoming administration, the general has this to say.
My friends, just because one side wants peace doesn't make peace. We must go ahead and do things that induce the others to want peace also.
Eisenhower implied that he would use atomic weapons against the Chinese if it was the only way to end the war.
If you threaten to use atomic weapons, you have to be credible. In other words, to where the other side believes you. Well, they believed Eisenhower, and I believed him.
Even without the threat, the war would have ended soon. After 3 years of fighting and more than 30,000 American soldiers killed, the war ground to a halt. A stalemate with no winners, merely a ceasefire. But Korea had changed American attitudes. Just as the limitations of nuclear strategy had necessitated conventional warfare in Korea, the price of conventional fighting would lead to more dependence on nuclear strategy, a cycle that would be repeated again and again in the years to come. By 1953, when the war ended, the U.S. nuclear stockpile had tripled thanks to massive spending under NSC 68. The U.S. now had about 1,350 atomic bombs, at least 10 times more than the Soviet Union. And U.S. scientists were pressing ahead with the hydrogen bomb, a weapon that would add a totally new dimension to the nuclear age. In November 1952, on Eniwetok Atoll, the U.S. tested the world's first thermonuclear device. The explosion was 600 times more powerful than the bomb dropped on Hiroshima. The atoll disappeared completely. For the moment, at least, the nuclear balance had shifted in America's favor. It would take only 40 or 50 such bombs to destroy the Soviet Union.
I looked at it the same as many other individuals that have been in the development of weapons, that when it's possible to develop a new weapon, you're derelict if you don't do it. Somebody else is going to do it, whether you do it or not.
As far as the Soviet Union is concerned, it was a very clear signal, as it was to the rest of the world, that we were out to rely on weapons of mass destruction for the security of the United States.
But the Soviets were hard at work on their own hydrogen weapon, moving directly from their success with the atom bomb.
I started with, in our group, with others to construct a small accelerating tube in which we used reaction deuterium plus tritium. That was exactly the reaction which is used in nuclear, in hydrogen weapon.
In 1953, within a year of the American explosion, the Soviets were ready to test. The nuclear age had entered a new era. Both sides were now armed with weapons that could destroy the human race. A series of seemingly logical decisions had brought us to a chilling paradox. From this time forward, to protect ourselves, we would risk annihilation.
And there were people who just sort of wrung their hands at this man's stupidity, or humanity to man, or whatever it was. Won't these people ever stop? And the answer, well, not now.
Even today in South Korea, they practice once a month for a renewed invasion from the north. If it ever happened, this time there would be plenty of nuclear weapons to go around. This program was produced by WGBH Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. Major funding for War and Peace in the Nuclear Age was provided by the Annenberg CPB Project. Additional funding was provided by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies, for over 100 years providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. And by the W. Walton Jones Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, public television stations, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. War and Peace in the Nuclear Age is a college course with textbooks published by Alfred A. Knopf. For information about the television course and related video cassettes, books, and off-air taping rights, call the Annenberg CPB Project at 1-800-LEARNER. The companion book to War and Peace in the Nuclear Age is now available. Written by John Newhouse and published by Alfred A. Knopf, the 512-page hardcover can be ordered by calling 1-800-441-3000. $24.95 plus handling. Please have your credit card ready.
At the height of the Cold War, a cheaper and improved technology added thousands of tactical nuclear weapons to the U.S. arsenal. But the Soviets were not far behind. Next time, how fear, money, and Soviet bluff triggered the greatest arms buildup of the century. Bigger bang for the buck on War and Peace in the Nuclear Age.